What's going on, everybody? My name is Zach Hartley, and welcome back to the channel. In this interview, we are going to be speaking with Brandon Beavis. Brandon is one of the largest YouTubers in the finance space here in Canada. He is also the CEO and founder of the Investing Academy, and he is an angel investor. And so in this conversation, we are going to talk about Brandon's portfolio. We're going to talk about how he picks and chooses the investments that fit within his portfolio. We're going to talk about the best advice he has ever received. We're going to talk about his angel investing. And we're going to talk about a variety of other topics. I am very, very excited. I watch pretty much all of Brandon's videos. I like what he is doing. And it's honestly a real pleasure to get to chat with him here. So I hope you enjoy it. Let's jump right in.
All right, Brandon, thank you so much for joining me here on the podcast. I sincerely appreciate it, man. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good, Zach. Thank you. I'm excited to be here. I'm looking forward to chatting stock. And yeah, thank you for the invitation. This is going to be a blast.
Me too. No, this should be good. So to start us off here, can you give the people just a quick run through of who you are and how would you personally describe your own investing style?
Okay. My name is Brandon. Run a YouTube channel that, you know, you may have come across, one of the larger ones in Canada. So I've been doing that now for 5 years, Zach. So it feels like time flies, but yeah, it was 5 years ago that I started that. But as on the investing front, I've been investing since I was quite young, like literally 10 or 11 years old. And I can really credit my father to that. He was an advisor. He managed money at his practice in Richmond for 25 plus years. So pretty much as soon as I was walking and talking and doing things, I was, you know, putting money in mutual funds and investing. I've always been a long-term investor, and that's something that will always resonate with me. We very much like to follow kind of that slow and steady philosophy. No trading, no risky options. It's just outside of the realm of what we like to do. It's very much blue chip stocks. We do pick individual stocks. So that's one thing that differentiates, you know, myself from, let's say, an index fund investor or an ETF investor. My portfolio consists of about 26 individual holdings. But yeah, we're scattered all over the globe, Canada, US, international investments, all via individual stocks is how I've opted to build my portfolio.
Beautiful. And when you're kind of constructing this portfolio, are you building it for dividends and cash flow, or are you building it for long-term appreciation, or are you looking for kind of a combination of both?
Definitely a combination of both. So I see both sides of the spectrum, and I don't think either side is necessarily bad. It depends on, you know, what you want out of your investments and your lifestyle. I don't entirely resonate with the pure cash flow option where it's just dividends and your capital is depleting, but you got this nice cash flow. Again, for some people that's great, but for me, my goal is to grow that portfolio size. And that is coming from a mix of both growth stocks. And when I say growth, it's not the speculative, small cap penny stocks, growth being, you know, the big blue chip growth stocks, but definitely a priority on dividends. I think dividends, passive income is very hard to, you know, complain about. And the reliability that I believe dividend stocks offer in general is, it says a lot about a company when they've been paying dividends for 30, 40, 50 plus years. That's not a small feat to accomplish. And to me, it just goes to show the quality of companies that you're looking at. And those are the ones that I would love to fit into my portfolio.
I love it. Now, I've talked to a couple of people, and when they say they're a long-term investor, for some people, that's 5 years. For other people, they plan to pass these stocks on to their children. How do you think about time frame when you're building out the portfolio that you just described?
That's a great point. The long-term definition is so different for so many people. But for me, Zach, it is multiple decades. So I'm 27 now, and I basically want to, you know, the way I like to view it is I don't want to touch this money till I'm at least in my 50s or 60s. And about a year ago now, actually, a year ago from this week, I had my first child, right? My daughter, she turns one this year. And it's something that never crossed my mind prior. But like you said, passing money down is now a very serious thing, like being able to have that capital, whether it be via an inheritance or paying for their schooling, whatever it is. So yeah, growing that asset pool is quite important to me, which is again, what kind of pulls me away from strictly like a passive income strategy where the dollar figures may be declining or depreciating. Definitely a goal of mine is, you know, over the course of at least a couple decades, that's what I would consider long-term, and nice, growing that asset pool as large as possible.
Congratulations on the baby, by the way. That's really exciting. I watch your YouTube channel, and I'm also aware you bought a property, I want to say, a year or two ago. So yep. when you look at, like, basically your net worth, your entire investment portfolio, Do you look at it and say, okay, I've got one property, I want to put the rest of the money into the markets? Do you plan on buying another property? How do you look at that as like the big picture?
Good question. So I actually have two properties, I can say, luckily enough, you know. Times were going well and, you know, business was doing well. So yeah, I have my own home, which is a townhome that I live in. I also have a rental condo, which I kind of outgrew with the family. And the reality is, because I live in Vancouver, it's so expensive, man. Like, you know, and there's many places, you know, throughout Canada where that is the case, where the real estate prices are just so expensive. A lot of my money, in all honesty, is being allocated towards real estate. And that's honestly not so much like by choice, but by necessity. You know, my mortgage payments keep going up and it's just freaking crazy. So right now, actually, the allocation for me is more real estate than stocks. I wish that wasn't the case. But, you know, at the end of the day, we need a place to live. And I made the decision, I weighed the pros and cons about, you know, maybe going out to Calgary or whatever the case is. And it's like, this is where we wanted to kind of root ourselves. And with that comes sometimes, you know, more money being allocated to real estate. So as an investor, if I call myself an investor, you know, there's many different assets. And one that I would throw out as of recently is even like, you know, angel investing, which is so new to me, but I know you're kind of into that. And that's like, you know, again, it's just another type of asset, and I need to, you know, deploy my money in various spaces. But I do make sure that, without a doubt, real estate and stocks, my stock market portfolio, those are the two priorities that I think will get me to my long-term goals.
And are you interested in any other asset classes? Like, I know Masterworks has been popping off. You've got crypto, you've got Pokemon cards. Is there anything else that you're dabbling in?
Long story short, no. So crypto's been something I've never understood, never really cared to dive into. Even I know a lot of people would look at things like gold and like these, you know, physical gold bars, bullion, and you do get a lot of, you know, convincing arguments for that. But I've always kept to the boring stocks. You know, the data shows to me this is the place to be. And I'm not interested in the Pokemon cards or the baseball cards, mainly stocks and real estate.
Nope, fair enough. Stick to what you're good at is kind of my motto. When it comes to your portfolio, do you have any favorite positions or ones where you're like, geez, that one was the best decision I've ever made? Do you have any that like really stick out to you that you would be willing to share with the audience?
Yeah, of course, willing to share. And it's funny, it's different than, let's say, a trader, Zach, where, you know, you could look back and be like, hey, this was a great success, you know, because you can like see it and, hey, I did this and this is the result. With my strategy, the way I see these payouts is literally, like I said, not until decades down the road. And, you know, obviously we can see since I've purchased a stock how well it's done. But what gets me most juiced up, and it's so lame to say, but, you know, my favorite stocks are the ones like the TD Banks. Brookfield Asset Management is another one that I've owned for years and is just a favorite of mine. But like literally, you know, prior to coming on this call, when the market was open, I added some Royal Bank and Pfizer to the portfolio. It's like, nothing flashy, nothing exciting, but those big reliable companies, you know, TD, Royal Bank, they do get me, they get me excited. It's funny, but they do. So nothing too exciting from that standpoint, but, you know, I feel a lot of comfort adding to those types of names, and it's kind of a lame answer, but that's what I'll give you.
No, I can appreciate it. As I get older, and especially as I get further and further out of kind of university, the dividend and steady, non-stressful holdings get more and more exciting and appealing to me. So I'm slowly coming your way.
They do. And it's like, especially with a year like we just had, you know, it hits differently, right? When times are good and you're in these small caps and they're doing great for you, like, that's awesome. And for so many investors, that's so much fun. That does come with the downside, of course. And that's the game you play in. You gotta live and die by it. And I just find, yeah, the dividend approach, you sleep easy at night. I don't have to worry about Royal Bank or Pfizer for that matter. You know, I'm not losing sleep over those companies. And I can definitely see the case where as you get older, you know, you start to lean heavier toward those for sure.
Yeah, no, for sure. So, okay, the next question here is one that I've asked a lot of people, and I'm particularly interested in your answer because your dad was in this industry, but it's, what was the best piece of advice that somebody has ever given you? Like, what is the one thing that's always stuck with you where you're like, damn, that guy, looking back on it, he was right about that one thing? Like, was there anything that stood out and you're like, that was the best piece of advice that still rings true today?
It in terms of investing, there's so many snippets that I've heard, you know, from a certain person just online over the years that are so true. You know, it's so funny, you know, like a lot of people dog on Warren Buffett these days. They say he's old and whatnot, but you know, for me, it's just quote after quote, whatever that guy says, you know, Warren Buffett, Charlie Munger, Benjamin Graham. I mean, it just, to me, again, that's what I resonate with. It's just like, they just keep getting ticked off as truths. And it takes time to sometimes realize that. But basically, I don't know the exact quote, but basically more, you know, concept of the idea is like, I was taught very early on that when there is excitement around something like hype, whether it be a marijuana stocks or a Bitcoin or crypto, whatever it is, like whenever there is excitement around something, some of the best advice I've got is to stay away from that. Right. And it's, you know, you spin that in many, many ways, like be fearful when others are greedy, greedy when others are fearful, or really a million ways. But I very much think of investing as this psychological game more than mathematical, very much so. You know, you can crunch your spreadsheets, you can do your math, but at the end of the day, I firmly believe that, you know, what moves the markets at the end of the day, the ups and the downs is human behavior and fear, you know, greed, optimism, pessimism. And by understanding what the masses are doing and trying to do the opposite, to me, that is something that has proven to work out well. In the short term, it doesn't feel like that, but in the long term, you know, whether that means buying when stocks are down and then everything's depleted and it feels like the world is coming to an end, or vice versa, you know, when Tesla's going to the moon. And I very actively said on my channel multiple times, like, I just don't understand it. It's just the fundamentals, da da da. And people make fun of you and they laugh at you and they say you're missing out. And again, if you want to play the short term game, absolutely, you can get in and out. But as a long term investor, I found that doing the opposite of the masses is a little thing that's worked wonders for me. And I anticipate that to continue really for the rest of my life, because again, it's a human thing. It's a psychological thing at the end of the day.
For sure. Especially when you're talking about something that's based on hype or popularity, it's all psychology at that point. So diving into kind of the individual picks themselves, how do you evaluate stocks for investment? Do you have, like, how did Royal Bank and Pfizer get through your filter to the point where you're buying the shares? Is there a checklist? Is there a process? Is there a system that you follow? How do you go from 1,000 stocks in the market to 2 stocks that you end up buying?
For sure. No, that's a great question. And yeah, there is a process. You know, off the top of my head, I couldn't really pinpoint, you know, like a step one, step two, step three as easily as I would like, because each stock I find myself kind of dancing around. And you know, with a stock of that caliber, like a Pfizer or a Royal Bank, to me, I put these stocks that are just kind of like givens, that they're, like you said, there are thousands and thousands of companies to choose from. If I came across a random small cap or mid cap stock, you know, nothing about them, you know, there's a very good chance that you're going to find something wrong with them. Versus these caliber of stocks, like let's say the top, you know, 100 companies in the world or whatever, to me, they do pass that test of, it's like, yeah, it's bad to say, but you kind of have this like instinctual belief that, hey, these are good companies. Now, that clearly is not true for every one of those companies out there. And you do have the cases of these huge duds that are, you know, fooling the masses. But I do like to kind of think there is a level of comfort with these big blue chip names, if you will. Now, within that, there's many ways that I would approach a stock. I mean, the way I approached these two additions today, actually, that was more or less a portfolio decision. We had some capital to deploy and we were saying, what areas are we lacking? So almost filling voids within our portfolio. And Royal Bank was actually a new addition. You know, I've owned TD for many years, and this was like a complement to it, right? The two big dogs. And I like to own oftentimes a couple names in an individual sector. So that was actually more of a top-down approach, if you will, you know, not so much the company is specific, but more, what do I need in my portfolio? And like I said, it's different for every stock that we look at, but yeah, there's a number of resources and research tools that we use, you know, that help with analysis, like third-party research tools, Zach. I'm not sure if you use those too much, but we rely a lot on, you know, like there's like companies like Morningstar or a Seeking Alpha or simply Wall Street who, you know, they are professionals and they all, their job is to do the DCFs and to do this and say, hey, this is what we think. And here's the pros, here's the risks. Here's a, you know, the information, you make the assessment. And then from that, you kind of break it down. But that would be kind of a all over the place answer where you know, I kind of like to vet just instinctually, what are the types of companies I want to look at? Again, for the most part, I'm looking at good companies to begin with. And then it's more like process of elimination. Oh, this one's got a lot of debt. This one, you know, maybe the PE ratio is too high relative to the industry, to the peers. And I like to kind of work my way down to, I'm like, hey, this one actually looks pretty darn good.
Right on. No, that was a good answer. You brought up one topic there, and it was analyst reports.
Yes.
Some people, it feels like, live and die by analyst reports. Some people say that the analysts have no idea what they're talking about. What is your stance on how much value should a retail investor like me and you, or anybody put into an analyst report?
I think, Zach, like if I had to lean to one of the spectrum, I would lean to the part that says they don't know what they're talking about, because it's hilarious. You know, I was doing some research, you know, prior to this on a stock, and literally, you know, you have two companies, one saying it's a buy, one saying it's a sell, right? Overvalued. And it's like two completely different price targets. And that's just the nature of the beast, is you're always going to have a difference or a variance of opinions. And I would, one thing I can say for certain is that we should never take a specific analyst or company's projections and targets at face value, and that's all that we look at. Like, we need to take everything with a grain of salt. Like I said, I use multiple sources to kind of pick bits and pieces, because, you know, like I touched on earlier, in theory, and this is just my belief, but if investing was truly a mathematical game, right, like, then in theory, the best analysts should be the best performing. You know, if you have the best spreadsheets, you can do the best DCF calculations, you are the best at the numbers, then in theory, like, the smartest people at math should be the best investors. And that's far from true. And like I said, you could have two analysts, very respectable. One says it's a buy, one says it's a sell. They've both done their math. So the issue I find with let's just say a DCF model, which is such a, you know, common way of valuing stocks, is there are so many assumptions that need to be made. Like, there's so many. And even if you know a company, like, from top to bottom, you have the economy and you have the decisions of all these consumers, it's very hard to predict. So to sum up what I'm saying here, I love looking at them because it gives me a great starting point and it gives me some great insight on, hey, what they're thinking and why they're thinking it. But I never, ever act strictly off of an analyst's buy rating or sell rating, but it does absolutely factor into my ultimate decision.
That makes sense. And I've seen people on either end of that spectrum, and it's really an interesting topic. Speaking of factoring into your decision, how do, as a long-term investor, how do interest rates factor into your decision-making? Have they impacted your investing over the last 12 months? Have they changed your mindset? Have they impacted the strategy at all?
Good question. This is actually a really good question. And has it impacted the strategy overall? Not really. So the way I see it is, if I'm going to be an investor over 40 to 50 years, there are going to be time periods where interest rates are high. There's going to be time periods where interest rates are low. There's time with the US dollar strong. Like, there's a million different variables that we could look at. And again, that's more narrow focused, in my opinion. Again, it's timely. And when I say narrow, it could be a number of years that this impacts. But what I'm getting at is that over my lifetime as an investor, there will be these highs and lows in everything, including, you know, interest rates. The goal for me when I pick a company is that it is such a strong company that it can weather those storms, right? And again, I could throw out some names, but, like, you know, when I think of some of the top tech companies with these very high margins and, you know, basically no debt on the balance sheet, yeah, inflation and then thus interest rates going up, that sucks. But it doesn't hit these companies as hard as, let's say, you know, a company that has X, you know, million or billion dollars in debt and their variable notes are going up, and that's, it could hit them a lot harder. Whereas these companies that have, like, you know, literally billions of dollars in the bank, just sitting there cash on hand, they can weather those storms a lot better. So when I'm looking at the companies that I want to hold, I'm looking for companies that I believe can get through really any economic period. Where it has impacted my decision was, like, I've actually done, you know, not as much buying over the past year, which is kind of counterintuitive. Obviously, when stock market's going down, we want to buy. But, you know, when interest rates were rising and when the stock market started to kind of fall off, obviously hindsight being 2020, but especially just coming out of COVID, I just felt that, hey, there could have been more drops in store. And clearly it's you know, posed a pretty challenging environment for companies and investors. So yeah, we've been holding off. Like I have, you know, for me, I was just checking today. I got like 17 grand in cash still, which is a good chunk for me, right? Usually I like to be mainly invested, but we have been hoarding more cash over the past year, you know, looking to deploy slowly like I did today. But case in point being is that my strategy has changed in kind of response to that, but not so much the individual company level, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? Kind of like more macroeconomic, like is affecting my buys and sells. You could look at it like timing the market, but I believe the question you posed was like, does that factor into my research with companies? I still try to pick companies that are going to do well regardless of the economic times.
So you've mentioned that a couple of times, and just for like, let's say somebody that's new to the market, they've been trading for 1 or 2 months. I think I understand what you mean by a really good company, but somebody that's new, and maybe let's say Pfizer was a new name for them. How do they go in and they say, okay, this would probably be a company that would make Brandon's list of a really good company. How would you describe that to somebody that's brand new?
Great question. So some of the metrics that I think are just like critical to me, if I were to put a blanket kind of statement across the board, is, you know, a lot of investors, first of all, like looking at these small companies that aren't even earning really like profit. So that's like a given. If your company's not profitable and not profitable for at least a number of years, like at least 5 to 10 years, you know, and if it's so variable up and down, again, that's just too sporadic for me. Like I want to be able to look at a stock, you know, their history, look at their earnings and say over the past 10 years, they've been growing in a da 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 da, right? So that track record, in my opinion, has to be there. Obviously, top line, like revenue growth is great as well. That's what we need. And that'll ultimately drive bottom line. But at the end of the day, what's most important to me as an investor is basically net income earnings from a company, and as well, the cash flow that they're able to generate. Free cash flow is something that I look at all the time. So those metrics in and of itself can tell a lot about a company, like regardless of what sector it's in or what the company does. If you literally look at, is this company generating free cash flow or earnings at the end of the day? We want to see that trending in the right direction. And, you know, I did a video, this will probably get pushed back, but I did a video like last week on Taiwan Semiconductor, the TSM, right? Big chip manufacturer out of Taipei or Taiwan. And you look at the fundamentals in terms of revenue growth, in terms of earnings growth, or in terms of cash flow. And it is just like one of the best charts that you could look at. Steady trucking along year after year after year. So that's one thing that I like. Now, assuming that I kind of ticked off, I'm like, hey, this company looks to be good in that shape. Well, then I actually start looking for more like red flags. So like I will always go to the balance sheet or use a source that would essentially get this information for me and compile it up. And I want to make sure that this company is not in any heavy debt or liability situation, whether that be long-term debt, short-term debt. There's a number of metrics that you can use to essentially assess whether they have the cash or the capital, the assets, you know, on hand to cover their debts. Again, if it's close or the debts are way out outweighing it, well, then that may cross off my list. And I say, hey, the company's growing well, but this is a legitimate risk. And like I gave that example, you know, if a company has so much debt and now interest rates are going up and now they have to finance that debt, that's going to get more and more expensive. Well, you know, even if the company's a great company, that could be a big hindrance. So from there, I kind of like to tick things off. And of course, dividends, as I kind of touched up at the top, is something I almost always look for in my companies. I do own a number of stocks that don't pay dividends, but most of them do. And then I'll spend a considerable amount of time looking at, you know, the dividend, the metrics on that, like whether it is growing, how long they've been paying it, and then essentially marrying that up with the company's ability to pay the dividend via maybe a payout ratio or even like a free cash flow ratio, right? Like how much of their free cash flow can they afford to pay dividends with? That's kind of a long form answer of some of the metrics that I would look for. And there's like a million others. We didn't even talk about PEs and all that, but yeah, that's some of the things that I would look for, like pretty much across the board with a company that I am assessing.
No, that was a good starting point. I'm sure somebody can checklist that if they want to. So I appreciate that.
Right.
You mentioned earlier you're doing a little bit of angel investing. Can you talk to us a little bit about how does that work? How do you get into that? And how's it going so far?
Well, so far, hopefully going so good because, yeah, I'm very optimistic for what we're working on here, Zach. And yeah, this is like a completely new field to me. So, you know, I took some of my money, like my own dollars and backed a project, which is obviously a big risk. I basically come into the expectation that, you know, this money is like kissing goodbye. Like it's not like one of my investments in the stock market where I actually expect it to make me money. Here's, as you know, it's a toss up and the odds are heavily stacked against us. But at the same time, it's fun to be working on a project here because I am an angel investor in one of the companies, companies here in Vancouver that I've kind of engaged, but I'm also working closely with them. So that's fun where I get to be more hands-on and really involved. It's one thing to cut a check and just be like, hey, you do your thing and you put a lot of trust in them. And it's another thing to be like, hey, I have some sway here and I can actually help the outcome of this. So it's been a perfect little marriage in that standpoint. But in terms of an investment and a payoff, this is kind of fun. This is just fun at the end of the day. And I wish I knew, for maybe your viewers or listeners, I don't really know how you can actually be an angel investor. Like I'm sure there's companies out there like FrontFinder and whatnot, where you can back certain projects, even with smaller amounts of money. But for me, I happened to know the people and they were raising a little round. So that's how I got in.
Nice. Right on.
I know you're kind of experienced in that space. So I probably have so much to learn from you. Like I'm just a little rookie in this space.
No, I'm sort of the same way. I've done a couple of deals now, but I'm still very young and I haven't seen any big exits yet. So hopefully both of us that big payday.
Fingers crossed for us. Yeah.
Yeah, no kidding. If people want to learn more about you, watch any of your content, find out more about the Investing Academy, we didn't even get a chance to talk about that yet. Where do people go to find more info?
I would just say go to the YouTube channel. At the end of the day, that's kind of my main hub. And yeah, we have like Instagram and, we technically have a TikTok, which we never use. But yeah, YouTube is kind of like the main hub where there's, hours and hours and hours of free content there for you guys. So if they want to check it out, I'd say go subscribe, watch some videos. And yeah, we always mention the Academy. So then from there, they can click links and do their own research. But at the end of the day, it's just... if you resonated with my style of investing, this boring, non-sexy style, which is something we've said from the beginning, like since we started our channel, Zach, you go back and watch my first videos. It's like, my second video on YouTube was talking about bonds, like investment bonds. And it's like, that's something that I hope always, shines through is that we've been very consistent in our messaging and in our strategy. And for those that like it and want to follow along, I mean, hey, we're here to educate. So that would be the best place for people to find me.
Yeah. And honestly, your YouTube channel has been fantastic. And I think like what you said there, like the consistency and the just like steady theme all the way through has been really nice to see and good to watch.
Thank you. It's funny. I kind of like, I draw comparables to my investment strategy. It's like, hey, it's just slow and steady. The investments, you're just trucking along and hey, hopefully over the years it compounds. Well, with our YouTube channel, we never saw any huge spikes. We never saw any like, quote unquote viral videos. We've just been steadily trucking along, kind of like a portfolio, right? It's just funny how I look at it that way.
No, I think it's admirable. Great job. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. I really appreciate it. And I will link all of your stuff in the info section to this episode.
Thanks, Zach. It's been a blast, man. I hope everyone enjoyed. And yeah, we can do this again some other time.
That'd be great. Talk to you soon, Brandon.
See ya.